With me this afternoon on Skype from IXICO, I'm joined by Lammert Albers. Lammert, nice to see you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Andrew, and good morning from the US here.
Look, it must be about 5 months since you and I last caught up, roughly around the time you came on board as Chief Business Officer. How have you found things, and give us an update on what's been going on since?
Yeah, indeed, it's been 5 months. We've been pretty busy. Since I joined, I was, as you remember, first boots on the ground in the US. We hired additional boots on the ground. We now have a West Coast-based business development director, so we have really good coverage from a commercial perspective in all of the geo hotspots in the US territory, and we continue our work to really create that customer intimacy that I talked about the last time we met. And we do that directly with biopharmaceutical sponsors, and also at the same time in a parallel track with some of the clinical research organizations that are active in the neurology indications that are applicable to the work that we deliver at IXICO.
Tell me a bit more about why you've been building the team in the States at such pace. Is this in response to demand for your services? Are you seeing quite a big opportunity over there?
Yeah, absolutely. So the last time we spoke, I referenced the fact that outsourcing gravitates towards the US. We had an opportunity to attract some specific talent that has particular expertise in the domain expertise of IXICO. Really capitalizing on that opportunity, but also recognizing that we just really needed to expedite that customer intimacy process here in the US. So, since we talked, in fact, in November, we've been quite busy on the contract execution side of things. We signed 11 additional contracts, and that amounted to in excess of £3 million that we added to our backlog since that time. And all of these contracts are, in fact, contracts related to studies that are really in our areas of expertise, or the indications that we talked about. So there are study contracts in indications such as PSP, Huntington's, and Alzheimer's disease as well. So we signed a number of Alzheimer's studies, including one that we announced earlier this week.
And that's indeed with Vaccinex, and you're already working with them on a different trial, are you?
We were, yes. We started a collaboration journey with the Vaccinex back in 2017. Vaccinex is a biopharmaceutical company based here in New York State. They are NASDAQ listed, and the journey that we started with them in 2017 was on the molecule, or the clinical asset, called papinimab. And papinimab is a highly specific antibody that we started work with Vaccinex, with a team at Vaccinex, to support their Huntington's disease trial called the Signal trial. Now, what was really exciting is the fact that Vaccinex has now reported some results coming out of that Huntington's disease trial, and there were some really favorable impacts on two imaging modalities within that trial. So what we've seen and what's been reported by the Vaccinex team out there is that firstly, the Huntington trials demonstrated that there was a favorable impact on brain atrophy. And brain atrophy, we measure in that trial with MRI. So that's one of the core modalities that we cover at IXICO. The other very significant impact we've seen, and that's been reported by Vaccinex, was that there was significant increased metabolic brain activity. And this is measured with a modality what we call FDG PET. So that impact was seen for those patients that are on active treatment as compared to placebo, again, in the Huntington's disease trial. So I think it was no surprise to anybody in the market that Vaccinex chose to continue papinemab development in different indications for neurological indications. And one that's particularly suited, of course, is Alzheimer's disease. So we're very excited that we'll continue this collaboration with the Vaccinex team on papinemab in this Alzheimer's trial that we're going to be initiating pretty shortly.
Have you said what this expanded contract's worth to IXICO from a revenue perspective?
From a revenue perspective, we can't disclose the actual value of the contract, but what we can disclose is that we started an initial work order with the team to make sure that we can meet the initial timelines. And then because of the collaborative nature that we have with the Vaccinex team, there are some potential upsides for further work that we might be bolting on to that project as well. And that is really a very different dynamic that we have with the Vaccinex team as compared to some of the more tactical relationships that we have with biopharmaceutical companies. And that's obviously what we strive for always in these types of relationships. So we're very pleased with the progress, and we're very excited to continue to support the Vaccinex team going forward with this particular trial.
And more broadly, as far as the Alzheimer's space is concerned, what are your expectations as to how that's going to evolve over the next, say, 6, 12, 18 months?
So, the Alzheimer's market and landscape continues to be a very exciting market for companies such as IXICO. If you just take a step back and if you consider that Alzheimer's is still the sixth leading cause of death, and it's the only leading cause of death that doesn't have a disease-modifying treatment amongst those leading causes of death. In the United States, every 67 seconds, somebody's diagnosed with Alzheimer's. In 2050, we expect that every 33 seconds, somebody will be diagnosed with Alzheimer's in the United States. So if you look at this from a global scale, today there are 47 million Alzheimer's or dementia patients that are suffering. In 2030, we expect that to almost double to 76 million patients. And by 2050, we expect there to be 150 dementia sufferers around the world. So if you then look at the global disease burden from an economical standpoint, this is actually costing society $1 trillion today globally. And we expect that to probably hit about $5 trillion by 2050 when we get to those 150 million patients. So now if you then consider the development landscape and what's been happening on the biopharmaceutical side from a development and approval perspective, it's actually been 17 years since we had our last approval in Alzheimer's disease. This is unprecedented. This just doesn't happen in any other indication. What's more, of the handful, in fact, there are four approved Alzheimer's treatments that are, it's questionable how effective these treatments are. All these drugs, they basically have come off patent. And so there's a huge potential upside for essentially biopharmaceutical companies to continue development in this space. Now, what's happening out there is that we have 120 molecules that are considered investigational drugs that are in clinical trials in the Alzheimer's disease space. And if you consider that to stroke, which is the second cause of death globally, that's actually double the number of clinical assets that we have out there in development. So what's also clear is that in recent years, there's been very much a focus on the phase three side, on the amyloid hypothesis. And it's also clear that that's not been working out. So we've seen a lot of failures. We talked about that previously. So what's coming ahead of us right now, and we're already seeing some strong indications, is that there's going to be a pursuit to different targets, and different targets are being prosecuted as we speak for Alzheimer's disease. So Vaccinex is just one such example of a different type of approach. The Vaccinex compound is actually focusing on neuroinflammation. So Yeah. In summary, I think what we're seeing is that that IXICO has, you know, been well positioned. We got a leadership position in some of the neuro indications where we see fewer assets, such as Huntington's. We talked about that much, and PSP. We talked about it a lot as well. But there is a huge amount of work, and there are a huge number of problems to be solved in the Alzheimer's space. And so there's a terrific opportunity for biopharmaceuticals companies to leverage our expertise as we continue to basically tackle the fight for in Alzheimer's disease.
Indeed, Lammert, just a quick word before I let you go. How well prepared are you, not just in the States, but in all your offices, to deal with this COVID-19 outbreak?
So I think we're very well prepared, in fact. So IXICO has a very robust business continuity plan in place, and our specific BCP plans as it relates to COVID actually were initiated in January. So we've taken all the steps necessary and required to make sure that we can essentially continue to deliver service to our pharmaceutical sponsors. We've taken a number of active steps very early on to make sure that all of our staffs were equipped with the appropriate equipment and tools in order to work from home. Each staff member has also been provided with cross-training to make sure that we can expand our capability and our bench in case of sickness. And effective March 9th, we actually put in a travel moratorium to make sure that we don't have any staff continue to travel either, you know, across the pond or internationally. In fact, we also canceled any attendance to events and conferences. And we've seen that now retrospectively, conferences are being canceled. So that was the right decision to make early on. And we also have a very strong focus on virtual meetings, such as today's meeting, in favor of in-person meetings. So we continue to monitor the situation closely, and we will adapt as required. But in the meantime, we're really focused on the well-being of all of our staff across the globe, and to make sure that we continue to deliver normal service levels that our customers are accustomed to.
Very good, Lammert. Nice to see you. Thank you.